Hi, I'm Jean Shafiroff, and I'm on a mission. Anyone can be a philanthropist. My television show came from my book, Successful Philanthropy, How to Make a Life by What You Give. Won't you join me? Welcome to Successful Philanthropy. I'm your host, Jean Shafiroff, and this show is designed to highlight the work of philanthropic leaders here in the United States and then beyond. With us today, Sheriff Toulon. He's the Chief Law Enforcement Officer of Suffolk County, New York. Let's all welcome Sheriff Toulon. Sheriff Toulon, thank you very much for joining us today. And before we talk about what it's like to be Sheriff of Suffolk County, I want to talk a little bit about you personally and how you got to where you are today. What was your education like?
I grew up in the South Bronx and went to an all-boys Catholic high school. I went to Cardinal Hayes. After that, I attended a community college. I received my my associate's degree in business administration. I then went on and received my bachelor's in business a few years later because there was a gap between my education, and then went on to receive my master's degree in business administration. I started a second master's degree in Homeland Security Management, but in the middle of the program, I decided to pursue my doctorate in education, and I received my doctorate from Dowling College. I did receive a postgraduate certificate in Homeland Security Management from Long Island University, and then went on to Harvard University's John F. Kennedy School of Government to study through their executive leadership program.
So you are extremely well educated, and most people, when they think of a sheriff, they think of someone pulling them over to the side of the road on the Long Island Expressway or somewhere else, checking them out to see whether they're speeding or whether whatever. But you're a very, very educated man. And can you tell our viewers, what does a sheriff do exactly? And what does the chief sheriff do?
Sure. So the sheriff is the chief law enforcement officer in Suffolk County. The sheriff's office was created in 1683, and his or her responsibilities are to see the two jails in Riverhead and in Yaphank, which encompasses about 900 correction officers that work in those two jails. And then we have about 250 deputy sheriffs that not only patrol the roadways, we are in charge of issuing pistol licensing for the East End, those five towns on the East End of Suffolk County. We have a warrant division. We have a domestic violence division. And then we have, all of my staff are part of a huge community affairs effort to really go out and get into our communities to see what is going on and see how we can help.
So you have a lot of responsibility, to say the least. Now, what are the key problems in Suffolk County as you see it right now?
You know, outside of the gang issues, human trafficking, and the opioid crisis that is confronted throughout our nation are probably the three things that we're dealing with constantly in the law enforcement community. We do deal with the crimes that are committed, whether they are shootings or robberies or burglaries, but those three are three central themes that occur throughout all of our the cases that we have to deal with.
I want to talk about human trafficking. I would think as a resident of Suffolk County that that would absolutely not exist. There is human trafficking in Suffolk County. Can you tell our audience a little bit about what's going on in that area and how maybe we can help?
Yeah, sure. What happened was I was meeting with our federal partners, our federal law enforcement partners, discussing the gang issues here in Suffolk County. And they were very candid and said that they were more concerned about human trafficking in Suffolk County. And so what we did was we created the first human trafficking unit in the jail in the country. And what is occurring is that many young women, some as young as age of 12 years old, are starting to get trafficked from people that, you know, they are a very vulnerable population. They're seeking love. There's rejection in the household. There may be some substance abuse or mental health issues that's going on. And so these young women are vulnerable. When they come to us, they're 18 years of age or older, so we do not see them when they're younger. And so what my staff is doing is really interviewing them, identifying who the traffickers could be, so that we can work with other law enforcement agencies to arrest those individuals. But more importantly is assisting these women in reclaiming their lives and hopefully have them leave this type of this issue that they're confronted with and make them feel empowered to move on with their lives.
Yes, now is the human trafficking connected to the gangs in Suffolk County?
You know, you would think that, and it's starting to increase just a little where there's a correlation between the gang issues and also human trafficking. We've seen it more so since the pandemic has occurred, but prior to the pandemic, it was really a small percentage of women where there were actually gang involvement. And you know, it's all types of gangs. It could be motorcycle gangs. It could be the traditional gangs that we hear about, the Bloods, the Crips, or the MS-13. But it's just that it's been a slight uptick with gang involvement, but prior to COVID, it was a very small percentage.
And how concerned are you about the gangs in Suffolk County?
You know, I was very concerned when I took over. I worked on Rikers Island for 25 years before being elected to sheriff. I started as a correction officer and completed my career as a deputy commissioner of operations. And one of the things I did when I took over as a sheriff is I went to El Salvador in April of 2018 to get a better understanding about MS-13. And then in November of 2018, I went to Los Angeles because the Bloods, the Crips, and MS-13 all originated there and somehow have migrated to the East Coast where we live. Suffolk County is the third largest populace of the MS-13 population, the first being Los Angeles, the second being that DMV corridor, which is DC, Maryland, and Virginia, and then Suffolk County. And so working with the Suffolk County Police Department, our East End Police Departments, and also the Suffolk County District Attorney's Office, we've really taken a big dent in this gang, with the gang issues here in Suffolk County. Our district attorney arrested the largest MS-13 gang involvement with almost 100 individuals last year. And I suspect that we're going to be able to do more to really eradicate the gang violence and gangs in Suffolk County.
And are the gangs connected to the opioid trade?
You know, and I'm sorry for interrupting you, but it is a small portion because they are selling. Some do use, but mostly they're selling, and it's part of how they make money because some of these criminal enterprises, they are businesses to them. And so selling drugs, whether it's marijuana, cocaine, crack, opioids, are part of their industry to keep themselves flourished. And part of us, as far as the law enforcement community, to eradicate them is really going after these other issues that they're dealing with outside of the violence, whether it's human trafficking or it's the opioid crisis, to really help to reduce their influence in our county.
I understand. Now, you became sheriff 4 years ago, and I understand you are the first Black American to be sheriff of Suffolk County. You were elected, and I believe you got involved in the election process just about 55 or 54 days before the election occurred. Can you tell our viewers a little bit about that process and what it was like?
Yes, I entered the race in about 53 days before election day, and I felt like I was very, very qualified for the position, and it would give me the unique opportunity to have a direct influence on the people that I live with, the community that I, you know, reside in. I've lived in Suffolk County for over 30 years now. You know, having worked in New York City, you don't have that direct impact with the people you work with or the individuals that are incarcerated. And so, you know, running for office, you know, was extremely tough. There were very little micro signals of racism that did occur as I was on the campaign trail, sometimes in the veil of the party that I represented during the election. But I do think that the voters and my prior community involvement helped propel me to win the election.
Now, in Suffolk County, do you think racism is a big problem?
You know, I do believe that in certain areas of Suffolk County, it is a big problem. I don't see it with our law enforcement community. Even before I entered the sheriff's race, or even becoming sheriff, you know, there are certain individuals that have an implicit bias against a person. It could be because of the color of their skin. It could be because of their hairstyle, the way they dress, because of the accent that they speak with. And so I do think that there is still a long way to go for us here in Suffolk County to really improve race relations.
No question. And hopefully moving forward, we will improve race relations. And I think we are going in that direction as a country. And when you look at Suffolk County and its problems with racism, how do you compare those problems to the rest of the country?
You know, I think we are a county that's very progressive and moving forward. I mean, you know, to have a, you know, at the time that I ran for office, there was more of the other party, and I'm a Democrat, so there was more Republicans that were registered, and yet they still felt that I was the most qualified individual to lead the sheriff's office. So, you know, there had to have been votes for both sides, considering I only got in 53 days before the election. I think people saw me for who I was and what I wanted to do for the residents of the county, keeping them safe, working on rehabilitation programs for those that are incarcerated so that they don't reoffend when they return back to our community, and just being a sincere individual who, you know, who has had a lot of life experiences and just wants to serve our community.
Now, I want to talk about our prisons here in Suffolk County. What have you done or what do you want to do for prison reform? We have a lot of problems with our prison system. And as we've seen, our state is now a no-bail state. Talk a little bit about this to our audience and what are your views?
So, you know, my issue with the no bail is the fact that when someone is released from court and they have mental health issues or substance abuse issues, the courts are not directing them to any proper services so they don't reoffend. So if someone has a mental health issue and they return back to our community, what has changed other than the fact that they were released from court and now they can possibly reoffend? We've taken a very proactive approach in the Suffolk County Jail now. We have robust rehabilitation programs for our women, for our 18 to 26 year olds, even for those that are 55 years of age and older. Prior to me becoming sheriff, or I should say, prior to COVID occurring, I was in 1 to 2 schools per week talking to students about bullying, vaping, opioids, and gangs. And then, as I just mentioned, the rehabilitative programs that we have, where we have small engine repair, carpentry skills, landscaping, anger management, parenting skills going on inside. We've developed some programs when individuals leave our custody. We partnered with Stony Brook University to develop a family reunification project so that individuals who are incarcerated don't lose the connection with their families, reduce the stress and tension. And they've provided the graduate students in the School of Social Welfare to be part of this program with the inmates, the families, and my correction officers. And then we created a START Resource Center. START is an acronym for Sheriff's Transition and Reentry Team for post-incarceration, so that when they leave our facilities, they have a place to go to connect for jobs, housing, healthcare issues. We provide, when they leave us, a care package with non-perishable foods. We give them personal hygiene items if they don't have transportation to where they need to go. We will drive them to where they want to go, whether they're staying with a friend or they have a home to return back to. And this resource center is not only for those leaving the Suffolk County Jail. We're working with individuals returning from state prison. And we're also working with individuals who were involved with the justice system in another state but now reside in Suffolk County. Because we figured if we can get to them, they won't reoffend and it keeps our community safe.
Well, no question, reform programs are key, because someone coming out of prison, if they have nothing to do and they can't get back into the workforce, well, it becomes a very big problem. And I think as a community, it's really up to all of us to try to see that these programs move forward. And I'm glad to see that you also think that prison reform and then reform programs, so that when our prisoners get out, they have something to do. I'm glad you see that that's very important and you're working on those. Now, what advice would you give to our young viewers, someone who maybe wants to go into your field, wants to become a sheriff? How important is education? And what exactly would you suggest to these young people?
You know, I think, first of all, they should never give up on their passion. You know, don't let anyone dissuade them from pursuing an occupation that they want to pursue. You know, law enforcement is a tough field, But I do think that it's a very, not only rewarding, it provides financial security and stability for an individual if they're looking for, you know, a career and not just a job. But more importantly, the thing that you stress is so important is the education. Because with that education, it's something that will help them move through the ranks. It will help them better understand the community that they serve, that they're serving. It will also help them become better leaders. I don't think that I would be the type of person I am if I didn't pursue my education, which I really have to thank my parents for really staying on top of my brother and I for pursuing, you know, our education. But it is so important to move through the ranks, to become better leaders, to develop yourself, you know, consistently. And sometimes you have to take some breaks, but don't ever stop learning, whether it's reading a book, taking a certificate class, or actually receiving a formal degree.
No question that education opens many doors. And I'm always saying to young people, get as much education as possible. And Sheriff Toulon is saying the very same thing. And he's a prime example of a young man who's received a lot of education. He's really moved forward. He's doing a lot of great work as Chief Law Enforcement Officer of Suffolk County. Now, I understand, Sheriff Toulon, that you are a cancer survivor, a 2-time cancer survivor. Tell us a little bit about that. And I understand now you're involved in a charity to work with people who also are cancer survivors.
Yes, I had Hodgkin's lymphoma in 1996, and then in 2003, I was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. And I had promised myself if I was able to get through, especially the pancreatic cancer issue, that I would really try and do something really good with my life. Not that I wasn't doing anything good then, but really elevate that goodness to a different level. And so it's a passion of mine to work with New York Cancer and Blood Foundation to assist cancer patients who are having trouble meeting their daily bills. And so this particular foundation works with cancer patients, not only with those that are in their practice, but others, if they meet a certain financial threshold, to really assist those individuals, because sometimes it's difficult to make your mortgage or rent payment, pay your electrical bill, put food on the table for yourself or your children. And so if we can help alleviate these costs for cancer patients and they can just concentrate on getting well, you know, something that I really appreciate what Dr. Jeff Fisurka and his team has done.
I have another question now, and that is related to your philanthropic work. As Chief Sheriff, do you feel that you've done enough or do you want to do more? What's going to happen from here?
You know, I definitely want to do more. I think there's so much more that I have to offer and assist the county and its residents, not only with public safety, but also with those individuals that have mental health issues or substance abuse issues. You know, I tell many individuals that the people in our jail, 85 to 90% of them are returning back to our community. Only 10% go to a state prison. And so those are the same individuals that are in a store that's either in front of you or behind you. If they're in the movie theater seated next to you when movies were open, they do not have a scarlet letter that says jail or just got out of jail. And so what I want to do is make sure that our community is safe, make sure that the children in our community have confidence in law enforcement, and we're someone that are good role models for these young kids so that they feel safe if they have issues, and that generally that Suffolk County is a great place to live and a safe place to live.
I like that. And we also want it to be a place where everyone is comfortable and where race no longer plays a role, where people look at each other for who they are and not for the color of their skin. And it sounds like you're working on race relations as well. How difficult is it now to recruit people into law enforcement?
You know, after the tragic killing of George Floyd in May of last year, and especially the anti-police sentiment, it's extraordinarily difficult to not only recruit, but recruit people of color because they've lost confidence. And, you know, those are the individuals that we want to recruit to be role models in the communities, especially the minority communities that we're serving in. And so now it's a matter of building that trust back with them and also hopefully imploring upon individuals that this is a good profession, it's a safe profession, and the only way we can make a change is if all of us get involved in some shape or fashion to really make it better.
And I think also perhaps the training of our law enforcement has to be slightly altered to include more information on race relations and treating everybody equally. And I think that's really key. And I would imagine you would agree with me also.
Yes, we implemented last year an implicit bias training for all of our staff. But more importantly, when you think about things that occur that are bad incidents in law enforcement, it's generally because of poor training or poor supervision. And that's why it's very important for leaders of law enforcement organizations to hold all of their supervisors accountable for the actions of their subordinates and really ensure whether it's a necessary training that needs to occur, whether it's a suspension or even a termination. If a person is no longer able to do the job, there has to be some serious considerations, because we cannot have people thinking in a different mindset than the leader of the organization.
Well, you are a wonderful leader, and I want to thank you for all of your advice, all of your work that you're doing for Suffolk County. And now getting back to the key problems of Suffolk County, for our viewers, what advice do you give to them if they want to live a good life here in Suffolk County and they also want to be helpful? Because there are programs all over our county to help with reform, programs to help with many different charities. But what advice do you give to our citizens?
I think, especially when it comes to the Suffolk County Sheriff's Office, is for people feel comfortable to reach out to us if you have an issue, if you have a suggestion. Yes, many of us have been in the profession of law enforcement for, you know, probably our entire lives, but sometimes we don't know it all, or we don't see everything that's happening. And we need the community involvement to really make ourselves better, to make our community safe, and to really move forward with all the issues that we're confronted with, whether it's mental health, substance abuse, the opioid crisis, race relations. You know, we have to talk, and we have to talk about the things that are uncomfortable so that we can be then hopefully comfortable, or our children could be comfortable in the years to come.
And one thing we did not speak about was the COVID-19 pandemic and how it's affected Suffolk County. And looking forward, it looks like we are going to have a lot of improvement in the situation. But how has it been for you and dealing with the problems related to the pandemic?
You know, for the jails, because it's such an enclosed space, is historically viruses like this would really spread rapidly. But we started planning the end of February, once, you know, because January 19th was the first case in the United States, March 1st was the first case in New York State, and March 9th was the first case actually in Suffolk County. And so we started planning, we put in certain protocols to actually have inmates wear masks, staff wear masks, temperatures were taken. And up until right before Thanksgiving, we only had 3 inmates that had tested positive. And if you look at other jails and prisons throughout the nation, there were no numbers that were even close to ours. Unfortunately, in December, we had about 40. We were back down to 6 in January. We only have 4 right now that have tested positive. So we've really implemented a lot of measures to make sure that the inmates and our staff are safe, including the mask wearing and the temperature taking, and also social distancing. But it is a challenge because the staff are wearing masks sometimes for 8 or 16 hours during a tour. Inmate activities have been reduced. They do not have the visits the way they used to because, you know, we're doing our best to keep the virus out of their facilities. So everybody's had to adapt to the change, and we're lucky that everybody's been appreciative of the efforts that have been put forth, but also have been safe and mindful of what we're all going through.
Well, thank you very much. And for our viewers, we are with Errol Toulon, our chief sheriff of Suffolk County. He's been giving us some great information. And Errol, what last piece of advice do you want to give to our viewers?
That the Suffolk County Sheriff's Office and all law enforcement agencies in Suffolk County are dedicated to making sure that our public is safe, We want to continue to not only engage with our communities to find out what is going on with different trends that are occurring. And as far as being the sheriff, please reach out to me if you have any questions or any concerns. I'd be happy to assist you or come to community meetings when the restrictions is eased.
Well, Sheriff Toulon, thank you very much for your interview. You've been so informative and so helpful to all of our viewers and to me. I want to thank you very, very much. And I hope you'll come back on Successful Philanthropy again in the future. Thank you all for joining Successful Philanthropy. I'm your host, Jean Shafiroff, and I'll see you next week.